Hi, my name is Anuj Gupta. I'm from Tag Investments. Today we are going to talk about Market Outlook 2020. Well, this is a disclaimer. This presentation is for information purposes only and does not represent any financial or any other advice. Well, we'll want to start with how markets fared in 2019. So we were looking at Sensex, which gave us 14-odd% returns. The top 200 companies gave us 8% returns, and the top 500 companies gave us 7% returns in 2019. You can also see mid cap and small cap giving us negative returns of minus 4 and minus 8%. That is what predominantly you would have witnessed in your mutual fund NAVs. You would have seen a drop in 2019 and always been comparing it with the Sensex returns, that the Sensex is rising and it's at an all-time high, whereas my mutual funds are not giving the right kind of NAVs. That's predominantly because the mutual funds invest in a variety of stocks, starting from large cap, mid cap, small cap. While the large cap selective stocks would have performed good, but the mid cap and small cap almost dropped by minus 4, minus 8% respectively. In this slide, what we are trying to show you is the emerging markets outperformed India in the calendar year 19, which means 2019. So Russia, China, Brazil, US, Taiwan, Japan, UK, Indonesia, Korea all gave better returns as compared to the India economy. This is, we are giving a comparison on the market cap in the last 12 months. So that's an important parameter to see, where we are comparing the market cap of India in 2018 versus 2019. So it just rose by 3%. And that is where the opportunity lies in 2020. This is another interesting slide which shows that in December 2009, the promoters' contribution to the Indian market was 57%, which has now dropped to 50%. So as and when the FIIs and the DIIs flows, which is the foreign investment and the domestic investments through the mutual fund route, increases, and specifically in the investors' holding pattern increases. But we've seen in December 2019, the investors, that is you and me, the individuals, a percentage has dropped from 2009. It was in 2009, it was 16.5. In 2019, it is 14.6, meaning that the individual investors are yet to have faith in the Indian economy story. But at the same time, if you see the foreign investors and the domestic investors, institutional investors have increased their stakes. So that's again a positive sign. We're talking about decade by decade. So we've seen every passing decade, there is some particular market which actually performs well. So American market, European market, China market, emerging market is basically the Asian countries, and the India market. They have their own, you can say, spree of in a decade. At the same time, we've also witnessed that whoever wins in one decade loses in the next decade. Meaning to say, like US has performed from 2010 to 2020, US has been the winner. So we don't see US being the winner in the next decade. And it's quite evident that India and the Asian countries are going to be a winner. So this is again the chart which I was just mentioning. In the 2010 to 2020, USA predominant won the decade in terms of the returns. In 2020, our guess is that India and the emerging markets should be giving the best returns in the next decade. Another interesting slide, this shows the age-wise population of a few countries where we are trying to showcase that in India, almost 28% are in the category of 0 to 14 years, and 62-odd% is in the category of 15 to 59 years. Meaning to say, in the next 10, 15, 20, 25, 30 years, we have the youth coming into the next phase, which is between 25 to 35, thereby increasing the consumptions and thereby increasing their income pattern. If you compare it with other countries, you will see that most of the people are in their 60s or late 40s and 50s. So India has a lot of scope in terms of giving good returns in the next 10, 15, 20 years, for the reason because India's population is young. So the average population is almost 26 years compared to other countries. So we have the youngest population. This is another slide which just shows the age-wise population of different countries. So we again score the best. That is why we are very bullish in the Indian economy. This we are trying to show the GDP growth in terms of agriculture, industry, and services. So predominantly we are dependent on these three industries, industries, agriculture, and services on our GDP. So what we need to score more on is the industry. While we are doing very good on the agriculture and services part, we are yet to catch up more on the industrial part, which is Make in India concept, which the government is also trying to push. So as and when it catches up, we see a good growth in GDP. This is again just trying to show the generation between old age, middle age, and young age, where we are trying to show that because India is predominant in the young age, so we are trying to show that they are more of the worry-free mindset, whereas the middle class and the old age, they have a limited mindset, and the middle age are in the growing mindset. But as and when the young generation gets middle aged, they'll want to take more and more equity exposure because they understand risk comes with reward, and reward comes with risk. In this slide, we are trying to show the foreign institutional investors flow versus the domestic institutional flow. So whenever foreign institutional investors have pumped in money, which is they pumped in money in 2019, they sense a bullish trend coming to them in the next 1 year, 2 years. So in 2019, they almost pumped in 1 lakh crores. Compared to domestic institutional investors or retail investors, they pumped in only 58,000 crores. Meaning to say that 2020 and 2021 are highly bullish years, where we can expect India equity markets to perform well. This is giving you an overall return matrix where India markets have given almost 70% of the times they have given positive returns, and 20 to 30 odd percent they have given us negative returns. This we are trying to show the trend of the SIP investors. So somebody who has a horizon of 5 years and above, they have never witnessed a negative return in the SIP. This is a CRISIL research report. So somebody who has a 5 year and above goal should blindly trust SIP route. The risk versus risky, where we are trying to say that in case if you take specific bets, that can get risky, but if you take a diversified bet amongst various industries and companies, then although risk is there, but then you get rewarded for it. So that's on the risk versus report. So now we've all of lately we've started tracking the Sensex, but we should not be tracking the Sensex, but what we should be tracking is the market cap. So another important and interesting data to visualize is in 2018 we were sitting at a market cap of 155 lakh crores. And as we speak today, we are on 159 lakh crores, whereas the Sensex would have risen by 14 odd percent, but the market cap has just risen by 3%. Thereby, again, giving you a huge opportunity where we expect market caps to rise in 2020 and 2021. So this is the global ranking where we are. So India is at $2.1 trillion. The government is hinting at a $5 trillion by 2024, 2025, which should be easily available to us, achievable in terms of the next 5 to 6 years. So we have a lot to catch up with, but this is where we are on the global ranking. Another good, so this has been taken from ET Wealth, the source. So last year we saw an announcement by the government that the corporate tax rate have been reduced to 22%, and earlier it was 30% without surcharge. So this makes us at par with the other Asian countries as far as the corporate tax is concerned. So meaning that we'll get more investments flowing into India because of the corporate tax structure being reduced. At the same time, we've seen a huge measure by the government where they have merged few PSU banks into four. This is well before the budget, so the government is very, very clear that they don't want to put this into the budget, and they just want to come out with as many reforms as possible so that they can achieve their $5 trillion mark. As a successful investor, you should also know more about the market cycle. One investor who understands about the market cycle is generally a successful investor. So there are cycles in profit, economic cycle, regulatory cycle, government involvement with the economic cycle, the investor psychology, the real estate cycle, the commodity cycle, and the cycle in attitude towards risk. So somebody who understands these market cycles becomes a successful investor. This is the asset allocation quilt where we are trying to show between 2010 to 2019, who were the market leaders, which asset class was the market leader. So you can have a look, you can pause this video and have a look. But what I'm trying to point here is on the 2018-2019 data, where we've seen the small cap and mid cap actually underperforming by minus 13, minus 23 and minus 4 and minus 8% respectively. And that is where we see a huge opportunity in the mid cap and small cap space in 2020 and 2021. However, we are advocating an asset allocation basket and not being fully bullish and fully allocating our funds 100% in mid cap, small cap. The best way is through go through a SIP route. Where you should be investing. So there are three major ways how you should be investing. One is through a diversified investing route, which is through the mutual funds. If you want to do a concentrated investing, you should invest in through direct equity, which is stocks. And if you want to do focus investing, then nothing can beat portfolio management services. That's the PMS strategies. For 2020, this should be your investment basket, where you should have some large caps, some mid caps, small caps, multi caps, tax savings like ELSS, international funds. So this should be your investment basket for 2020. Well, this is in no way we are trying to promote these companies, but we are just trying to tell you that you should have a portfolio of mix of across sectors and mix of companies so that you get a well diversified portfolio. Last not the least, importance of advisor. So what we do as an advisory body is that we help you achieve your goals. So when you start your investments, you are actually lost. How can I achieve my goals with lot of volatility in the market and lot of investment products in the market? So you get confused and you end up just saving and not investing. Whereas with an advisor, you have a very clear route and we help you achieve your goals. So that's the importance of an advisor. The actionable points from this video is that one, you should be doing your asset allocation right. Second, this is the time when you should be investing in something called as balanced funds, which is also predominantly balance advantage funds and asset allocation funds. And in case your SIP is running, time to top up your SIPs. If you don't have SIPs running, then time to start an SIP now. Thank you so much for listening. Myself, Anuj Gupta from Tag Investments. This is our website and this is our contact number. In case